Welcome to worship this evening. This is our third midweek service during the season of Lent. We rise for worship. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God to all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Our Old Testament reading this evening is from the book of Exodus, chapter 3. Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then God said, Do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now, behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? He said, But I will be with you. And this shall be the sign for you, that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses said to God, If I come to the people of Israel and say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you, And they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Our epistle reading is from St. Paul's letter to the church at Rome, chapter 12. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. We rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 16th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. Then Jesus told his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his life? Or what shall a man give in return for his life? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done. Truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We continue with the responsory.
Deliver me, O Lord, my God, for you are the God of my salvation.
Rescue me from my enemies. Protect me from those who rise against me.
In you, O Lord, do I put my trust. Lead me not, O Lord, my God.
Rescue me from my enemies. Protect me from those who rise against me.
Deliver me, O Lord, my God, for you are the God of my salvation.
Rescue me from my enemies. Protect me.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. 2 weeks ago was Ash Wednesday, and we started in this journey through the book of Exodus. Last week we had a little bit of a detour as it was the festival of St. Matthias, but we're back on track today, and now we're in Exodus chapter 3. But back on Ash Wednesday, we talked about God doing big things with small stuff. We talked about how God has done that for us in the past with small things like nails and wood and a spear. How he used those small things to create salvation for you. He used an empty tomb to create eternal life for you. We talked about how he continues to do big stuff, big things through small stuff. We talked about water, bread, and wine, and a word. These small things do great things. They do big stuff. They create our unity with one another. They give us a place of refuge, and they grant us forgiveness and the strength to resist temptation. God using little things to do big stuff. We also talked about how not only the past and not just the present, but what God can do through you in the future. Little old me. How can God use me? And so we come to Exodus chapter 3. The last time we saw Moses, he was a small child. He was one of those little things that God is going to do big stuff through. And you remember that story. His mother is hiding him for fear of his life because he's a male Hebrew child. And to be born a male Hebrew child was a death sentence. So his mother hides him as long as she can, and then she takes him and she places him in a basket when she knows he's getting too big. She can't hide him anymore. She places him in a basket and sets him into the Nile River among the rushes, this place, this Nile River where he is sentenced to death. He's supposed to be thrown into this place. But he goes through it. And the Pharaoh's daughter hears his cries, and she sends her servant to come and get him and take him up out of the water, and she rescues him there. And God sets Moses on that path to do big things. We don't hear much again from Moses until he is an adult. And the next time you encounter him, he has this incident. He has this episode with an Egyptian who is beating, who is violently abusing one of the Israelite slaves. Moses, seeing the injustice of it all, decides that he is going to do something about this. He can't let this stand, so he intervenes and he kills the Egyptian. Buries him in the sand in the desert. And he comes to his people again, and he sees two Israelites fighting. And now he says, now it is time for me to intervene again. I have got to do something for these people. And when he tries to stop it, they say, who are you? Who are you to lead us? And so Moses knows what has happened. He knows that word is out. And he doesn't really understand the connections. He doesn't understand the connections. How God is in his life foreshadowing what is to come. The death of the oppressor and his people escape into the desert, just as Moses does. He doesn't understand that. He doesn't understand that this is the future for God's people. He doesn't understand in his own life how his mother placed him in the water and he goes through the water, through that place of death, and he comes out on the other side safe and rescued. And how that's going to point forward to what he is going to do with the people of Israel. He doesn't understand that. He doesn't see that connection. He doesn't see the connection between God in heaven hearing the cries of the people of Israel in their oppression, and the connection to this servant girl who is told to go rescue this child out of the river because her master heard the cries. Moses does not understand that he is the servant of the Lord who has heard the cries of the people of Israel, and Moses is that servant to go and rescue God's people. Moses doesn't understand any of these connections yet. He certainly doesn't understand the connection that is coming, that Jesus is going to rescue not just this people from this place, but all people from sin and death and their slavery to them. He doesn't understand that connection either. He certainly doesn't understand the connection there between that and your baptism. He doesn't understand any of this. You know what Moses understands? I'm a wanted man. I better get out of here before they kill me. So he is here. He has created a new life for himself. Quiet, peaceful, a shepherd. He has found a family and found a home, and he is out in the wilderness, out in the countryside with these sheep. And there he meets God in this bush that doesn't burn up. God comes to him and says, Moses, I have a job for you. We read about that in our Old Testament reading. Moses, I have a job for you. I have something important to do. And so Moses there, who does not understand any of these connections, and the only thing he knows is I'm a wanted man, asks the same thing of God that the people had asked of Moses when he broke up the fight. Who am I to lead these people? Who am I to lead these people? I'm not enough. This last Sunday, Pastor Danny was preaching on not this text that we have from Matthew, but the parallel text in Mark, where Jesus tells his disciples to take up your cross and follow me. That is to go to the edge of your understanding, the edge of your patience, the edge of your endurance, and take another step. And how hard that is to do. And Moses is having that moment right here on this mountainside. Here in the presence of the Lord with a bush that doesn't burn up, even though it's on fire, and he's hearing voices from heaven, and he's telling me to go back to Egypt where I'm a wanted man, but all I want to do is stay here in my quiet and comfortable life and herd these sheep and live out my days in peace. Stay here in my comfortable, quiet life, or do what the Lord is telling me to do. That's the temptation that Moses faces. That's the same thing for us. Exist in our quiet, comfortable existence. Whatever it is it looks like herding sheep is for you, sit in your quiet, complacent, comfortable existence, or do what the Lord commands, which is much harder. The good news is you don't have to rescue anybody. The Israelites left Egypt a long time ago. Our Lord Jesus has rescued the world from sin and death. That is not your job. And we can all breathe a little sigh of relief for that. But the commands that the Lord does give us, even though not as drastic, are still difficult for us to bear. They seem just as hard. It could be something as simple as forgiveness. I'm not talking about the way the world forgives, where we just sort of bury our resentments with a little layer of politeness on top and we just sort of exist like that. Or the way the world refuses to forgive. Everything is held on to forever. It's on the internet now. It's never going away. but rather to forgive as the Lord forgives, not merely to paste over, cover over those things, but rather to receive that person back into relationship with us. Jesus says, if someone strikes you on the cheek, turn the other one to them, right? Turn the other cheek. What does that mean? It means this. If someone is close enough to you that they can hurt you, and they do, what is forgiveness, really, but to allow them to be that close to you again? To forgive as the Lord forgives. Or it could be something as simple as chastity. And I'm not talking about the world's view as this old-fashioned and useless idea, the way the world sees it, where lust and pornography and now even prostitution is becoming normalized, expected, and even celebrated. But rather, to be faithful to our spouses or even our future spouse. Never wavering in our devotion or our desire. This is what it means when the Lord says, if you look at someone with lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery with them. Jesus says you need to be faithful to one another the same way that our God in heaven has been faithful to us. Never looking aside, seeing us and us only. That command from God that is so hard to do could be even something as simple as humility. And I know that the world doesn't have a whole lot of use for humility these days, especially in our culture, but this has always been the case. It's just kind of hyper-ramped up these days. You know, humble people don't get on television. You got to get your likes and your shares. Look at me, look at my life, look at my happiness. Think well of me. But the Lord commands differently. He says, no matter what situation in life we find ourselves in, it's not the moment to get attention for ourselves, but rather to look at the other and say, their needs outweigh my own. That's what it means to follow Jesus, to go on his path of self-denial and sacrifice for the sake of the world, even a world that rejects the sacrifice as you are making it. Sure, I don't have to go and rescue a people out of slavery. I don't have to rescue the world from sin and death. But forgiveness, chastity, humility. Who am I to even try something like that? That's too difficult, too taxing, too much. I'm not ready, I'm not able. Who am I to even try? And that's the same question Moses asked. Who am I to even try to do the things that you're asking me to do? And Moses gets his answer, but it's not an answer he expects. I will be with you. I will be with you. Moses asks, who am I? Should I should go try to do something like this? God says, it doesn't matter who you are, Moses. What matters is who I am. It doesn't matter that Moses is afraid, that he doesn't think he possesses the gifts he thinks he needs to stand in Pharaoh's house and demand for God, for Pharaoh to let this people go. It doesn't matter that the people he is serving, the people he is there to rescue, don't want anything to do with him. It doesn't matter to him even when it's only that he's making things worse. None of that matters. Because it's God's work, and God is with him. So we may ask the question, who am I to even try to live the way that the Lord commands me to live, to be perfect even as my Father in heaven is perfect, that my righteousness would surpass even the scribes and the Pharisees? Who am I to even attempt something like this? And the answer is the same. I will be with you. Doesn't matter that we are timid, that we are afraid, that we are unsure of what is going to happen next. And we may not see the connections between past and present, between what we are doing today and what the Lord is going to do tomorrow. We don't see those connections. But what matters is that this is His work, and He will be with us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. We continue with our office hymn. For prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The prayers of the church this evening are especially requested for Connie Atwell and her family as they continue to mourn the passing of Don Atwell. His funeral is going to be this Monday. We pray for Bruce Haggerty, who had surgery this week, and for Susie Ward, who is recovering from heart surgery. Let us pray. O Lord, through your Holy Spirit, pour your love into the hearts of all those who suffer in our midst. This evening we pray especially for Connie Atwell and her family, for Bruce Haggerty and Susie Ward. Lord, let their sufferings produce endurance, endurance character, and character a hope that will not put them to shame. Grant them healing in body and spirit in accord with your perfect will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord God, you led your ancient people through the wilderness and brought them to the promised land. Guide the people of your church that following our Savior, we may walk through the wilderness of this world toward the glory of the world to come. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.
Just a couple of things this evening. Firstly, the Martin Luther Academy silent auction is proceeding. Even as we speak, that closes. They're having rolling closures of the different sections of that auction. If you want to know what I've bid on, I won't tell you because I want to win. Can't have some of you vindictive people trying to snipe my bids. All right. Also, the funeral for Don Atwell is going to be here at church 10 a.m. Monday morning, Monday, March 8th, 10 a.m. here. The seating for the funeral service is going to be very, very limited. We're going to create a sign-up like we do for a regular worship service, like you signed up for this evening, or if you come on Sunday, we're going to create a sign-up like that. We're going to populate that with the family just to make sure that they get on there. After that gets done, we will send a link out to the congregation to sign up. If you can't get a seat for the service, understand that the family is being very vigilant about the coronavirus and very cautious because there are some immunocompromised people in the family. So we're going to have very limited seating, but we will have a link to watch it live like we do our regular worship services, so you'll have that opportunity as well. All right, thanks to our dedicated technology folks who are setting that up for us. All right, I think that is it. Miss Cindy. Yes, yes, youth, junior and senior youth ice skating. Is it this Sunday?
Yes.
This Sunday. You need to RSVP to that by tomorrow to Miss Cindy so she knows how much pizza to get. Otherwise, you'll be sort of kind of picking up crusts or something. Ugh. All right. Just kidding. Okay, anything else? All right, God's richest blessings to you this week.